Morning, Gateway. It is so good to be with you on this beautiful Sunday. It's so nice to have a voice again. I gotta say, it was lovely hearing all of you sing last week, so thank you. Let's do it again this week. Let's stand up, let's sing loud, let's sing praises to our Lord. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter, the King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Thank you.
Morning, everybody. I just want to welcome you here to Gateway this morning. We're very glad to have you with us. And also, like Paul said, on a very nice and sunny day, it's nice that we're actually starting to get into the more spring-summer weather. So at least for me, it'd be good. So again, anyone unfamiliar with me or visiting this morning, my name's Garth, and I am the pastor here at Gateway. Just a few announcements for you this morning. First and foremost, just want to make you aware again, like I did last week, different ways that you're able to give. If you feel so inclined, you can do that online through our Church Center app. You just go in the App Store and download Church Center. You can set up an account. It'll connect you right to our church to give that way. You can do it in person. We have three offering boxes at the back of the room here by the doors. A little hard to see sometimes because they blend in with the wall, but they're there, I promise. You can do it online through a URL, which is connected to our Facebook page, as well as even if you just want to mail in money for us for giving, that's totally fine too. So just multiple ways in which you can give for us, that would be great. We do appreciate your generosity, again, recognizing this is actually an act of worship, of giving, and God loves a cheerful giver, as it says in 1 Corinthians. So I just want you to be aware of that. Next week, on the 21st, a week from today, we're having a prayer and praise worship service. There won't be a message that morning. It'll be strictly focused on just a time to gather together and sing praises to our Lord, spend more time in song, as well as praying as the gathered body of believers for specific things that God has commanded to pray in His Word. And so we'll read those scriptures and we'll pray according to what God has commanded us to do. And again, just spend that time together. This is something that we want to do throughout the year, not just once in a while, but something that we really just gather together, kind of rest, relax, worship, and pray, and bask in the presence of our Lord here. So that's next Sunday. I just want to point out as well, that will be a family worship Sunday, so there will be no kids worship during the service. There will be toddlers in nursery, and then there's no Bible study that morning either. It's strictly just the prayer and praise worship service. So we're looking forward to that. And then one thing as well, I know we haven't done this yet, and it's basically almost the end of April, but we are going to have a deaconess meeting on April 28th following the service. So not next Sunday, but two Sundays from now, we're going to have a deaconess meeting following the service. We'll probably meet back in the Awana room, which we will have to rename at some point, but that back classroom here near the youth room and this hallway. So just a reminder, that's April 28th, coming up 2 weeks from today for the deaconesses. So would you join me now as we pray for the service? Heavenly Father, we do praise you and want to glorify you for your love and goodness towards us, that through Christ you have made a way for us to be reconciled to you, that he was the perfect, spotless lamb for us, the sacrificial lamb who laid down his life, that our sin payment might be paid to you, that the power of sin over us might be broken. And then you raised him from the dead 3 days later, that the power of death in the grave would have no authority over us whatsoever, that we now share in the eternal life of Jesus Christ himself and have a firm and full confidence, a solid foundation upon which we stand, because we stand upon Jesus and no one else. Father, I pray that the service would be pleasing to you, that our hearts and our minds, our spiritual ears and eyes would be open and listening so that we could hear from your word, and that the Spirit would work mightily on our hearts to make us more like yourself. It's in Jesus' wonderful name we pray. Amen. I invite you to stand as we continue to sing. Thank you.
With all creation I sing. Let's pray together, church. Father, we thank you, God, that you are a God who is faithful. God, that you are a God that loves us so much. Father, that you sent your Son to take our place. God, to give us salvation. Father, that you right now are reigning. God, that you are over every situation. Father, and it's because of who you are that you are worthy of all our praise. Father, you know every thought. God, you know every struggle. You know every doubt. Father, I pray right now that where there's doubt, God, you will give assurance. Father, where there's sickness, you will give healing. Father, where there's struggle, that you will provide a way through because you are faithful. God, I pray right now that you open our hearts and our minds as we hear from your word. God, would your Spirit lead us to truth? God, speak through Garth. God, grow us, challenge us, change us, make us more like you. And thank you that you've called us to be a part of this church. Father, draw us closer to you. Everything is for you, and it's because of you. It's in your Son's name, the perfect, powerful, precious name of Jesus, the name above every other name. Amen. You guys can have a seat. We're going to dismiss the kids right now for their worship.
All right, I invite you to turn your Bibles to John chapter 2 as we continue our study here in the book of John. Something that becomes more and more evident, at least to me, as I read through Scripture, is how God is always moving his people towards something better. You know, and you can see a number of ways in which that happens, especially in the Old Testament. Maybe it's more obvious. I mean, he's moving Israel when they're enslaved in Egypt for 400 or so years, and he delivers them out of the hand of Pharaoh that they might worship him, right? That's the point there. It isn't Moses saying to Pharaoh, oh, let my people go, and then he stops that sentence. He says, let my people go that they might worship the Lord. That's the goal there. And then, of course, it does take them 40 years in the wilderness to get to the promised land, but that promised land was exactly that. It's what all their hopes and dreams could be fulfilled in. It was a land that was just filled with abundance for them, and although there had to be conquering involved to receive it, God was still moving his people as long as it possibly took, even if it takes a long time, is moving his people towards something greater. And ultimately, that's what God is doing with us, not that we have a specific promised land like Israel does, although I do still believe they'll receive the fullness of that kingdom in the future. I think that's a fulfillment waiting to happen for them once they finally repent and believe in their Messiah. But for us, we do have, in one sense, an even greater promised land. And it's not even heaven. Heaven's just temporary. Heaven's a holding place until we get to the fullness of God's kingdom on the earth. And we're moving in that direction. And what we're seeing in these signs that John records in his gospel for us with Jesus is a glimpse of his future glory. Right? These are just little minute ways of us to see the fullness of who Jesus is. Even if it might be temporary, even if it might be a quick glimpse, we will get the fullness of Jesus in the future. The perfect will come and be complete for us. And so something that I want us to see in the text this morning is a way in which Jesus is better. Now, Jesus is better in all ways. That's not a profound statement by any means. I'm sure we all agree on that. That's why we're here, to worship him because he is greater. But something that God does, which is really interesting to me, is he'll take physical things within this world and he'll say, oh, yes, this has a practical application and function for you, but it actually points to something even better that is on its way. And actually, he does that with the temple, and we're going to see really the fullness of this and what the temple is pointing to. It's pointing to the fact that Jesus is the better temple. And now maybe you've never thought about Jesus in that way, and that's actually the point of this text here as we'll go along through it, and I'll show why he is the better temple. There's some text that we need to go through first to understand the situation in the temple to understand what Jesus is saying about himself. But Jesus is the better temple. The temple itself was only ever, at least the one in Jerusalem, where the Jews would go to worship and meet the Lord, where the Lord manifested his presence in the inner room, the inner sanctum called the Holy of Holies, that only once a year could the high priest go into that room and be in the presence of the Lord, and he needed to make sure he confessed all sin and for all the people and himself, otherwise he would die in the presence of God, being that God is holy and he is not. That was a temporary situation. The temple was never meant to be a permanent fixture within the life of God's people. It was meant to point to the greater temple, the one through whom we have true and permanent, complete communion with God. Not just once a year, not just behind a veil, a very thick curtain where we can't actually be in his presence. No, the fullness of God and man for us. The temple, the better temple, Jesus Christ. So again, we'll expand that more as the message goes along, but that's what we're looking at, is how Jesus is himself the better temple for us. So I want to take this text in two parts. We're in John chapter 2, starting really in verse 13. Take it in two parts, 13 through 17, and then 18 through 22. The first section we see here is the desecration of the temple. Now, this is not when the temple is destroyed. That's not what I mean by desecration. What I mean is the worship of the Jews in the temple is evil. It's awful. It's horrific in the eyes of God, and that's primarily why Jesus will do what he does in this context. But let's read through it. We'll take a few verses at a time to see how this develops and see what is going on here. In verse 13, it says, "The Passover of the Jews was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem." Now, the Passover is itself the time of year that the Jews celebrate and recognize when God had, with their ancestors in the time of Egypt, the 10th plague, the angel of death, was coming into the land and would kill the firstborn of all the families, except for those, as God commanded, who would take a lamb, slaughter that lamb, spread blood from the lamb across their doorposts and above their door, and then they actually had a meal with that lamb as well. God commanded them to do that. Anyone who did that, then the angel of death wouldn't come to their home. They would be saved. God would pass over them. That's where the term comes from. And so once a year, and it's really around Easter time actually, each year, the Jews celebrate Passover. This is meant to be a recognition of God's love for them, his favor for them, his deliverance of them from the hand of the Egyptians that eventually led them into the promised land. So you would expect in the temple context in Jerusalem, the place where God actually is among his people, for it to just be filled with worship. This week-long celebration to recognize the goodness of God that people are flocking to Jerusalem for should be that environment where it almost feels like, in one sense, a worship and praise service. It's just constant prayer, constant singing, constant observing of sacrificial law as an act of worship. And yet that's actually not the situation that we're going to find ourselves in as Jesus comes to Jerusalem. I do want to point one thing out, which is kind of interesting in the text, to maybe more geographical, if you will. It says that Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now, if you look at a map and you see where Jesus is coming from, he's technically going down to Jerusalem. So how is it that the text is saying he's going up to Jerusalem when he's actually going from the north to the south to get to Jerusalem? The answer is this: Jerusalem is set on a hill. And so that's how the Jews always speak of going to Jerusalem, regardless of what direction they come from. They're always going up to the city. And you can see that imagery, because that's where God is. And so we have to go up to meet with God. So I just wanted to point that out in case you had a question regarding that. That's the image there. We are going up to Jerusalem because God is there at the tip of that hill. So notice verse 14, what's happening here. "In the temple he found those who were selling oxen and sheep and pigeons, and the money changers were sitting there." So instead of finding a place of worship, right, instead of finding a sacred place, you know what he finds? A marketplace. Of all things for the temple to be, a marketplace. And now, of course, when you look at what animals are involved here in the money changers, you realize exactly what's going on. Oxen, sheep, and pigeons. Those are all animals used in the sacrificial system. Now, the Jews were commanded if they were to make a sacrifice, and these all coordinate with a different aspect of the law. I won't get into the detail of that. Oxen typically involved certainly with a sin offering, making atonement for sin. You were, though, tasked, if you're a Jew and you're coming to Jerusalem, you were supposed to bring your own animal. You're supposed to bring the best of the best from your herd. And that is what you gave over as an offering to God. Right? This idea of a spotless or blemish-free animal that you give as an offering. Yeah, that is an economic blow. It is. Your best of the best that you could sell off or use for a feast or whatever it might be, you were supposed to offer up to God. Well, there's a deeper picture there. You're supposed to give the best of the best to God first and foremost, because all of it is from Him anyway. It's all on loan. It's all being borrowed. And so by giving up what was the best in their herd, that which gave them the best economic situation and stability, what they're doing is they're saying, but I'm stable not because of what I have, but because of God providing for me. Ultimately, this all comes from Him. So not doing that, and I get that some people are traveling, you know, dozens of miles, maybe over 100 miles to get to Jerusalem for the Passover. It's kind of hard to bring animals that far when you're just walking the whole time. You know, they don't have trailers like they do today. Yet they were still tasked to bring their own. Except what's happening now is in the temple itself, not even outside the temple, but in the temple itself, is a marketplace where you can go and you can conveniently buy an animal that you have no emotional attachment to and sacrifice that animal. Simply because you want to go through the motions of the worship, but your heart is far from the point of it. That's exactly what's going on here. And the money changers as well, you have people coming from all over the Roman Empire, right, who have different types of currency are coming, and there is a temple tax offering, if you will, where you're giving financially directly to the temple. That had to be in a specific type of currency. And so these money changers were there where you could go, you hand over your one type of currency, get the other one back that you can now give as an offering to the temple. Well, guess what these money changers would do? They would charge a percentage on top of that to make money on. So they're actually taking advantage, and we're not told if they're Jews or not, it doesn't matter in the context. Regardless, they're taking advantage of the worshipers coming in and getting a little bit more than what they were even originally offering. And so these money changers and exchangers are probably making a great fortune off of this. I mean, hundreds, probably thousands of Jews are flocking to Jerusalem, and they're getting a percentage of each and all of that. So it's just, hopefully you feel the weight of what a horrible situation this, what a desecration of the temple is. The temple is the place where people could come and through their sacrifice meet God. And yet here it's become a marketplace. Here it's become a place of business. Now, where in the temple is this happening? Because the temple is not just a building. There were different layers to it or different sections of it. The bigger outer area of the temple had a wall up so you could still enter into the temple area, if you will. But that outer region was the court of the Gentiles. So this is where Jew and Gentile could actually be within the walls of the temple, if you will, and they could intermingle and talk and do different things like that. The goal is still worship. The goal is still worship. But then you have another layer, another area even further in, closer to where God's Holy of Holy room is, that was really limited only to Jews. The Gentiles could not get past that area that was limited to just Israelites. That's actually more likely where this marketplace is happening. Simply, again, because of the context of what's being sold. A Gentile wouldn't be interested in these things because they're not there to make sacrifices or give an offering to the temple. And so likely, and a number of commentators that I looked up believe, this is that inner room, or inner area at least, that was limited to just the Israelites. This is actually the area where the altar was that they would make the sacrifice. This is actually the area where they could interact with the priests and they could make the financial offering. It was their place of worship. And just beyond there is the veil. Just beyond there is the curtain where God's presence was in the Holy of Holies. So even just a doorway away from God Himself, the people are abusing worship. And this is absolutely evil in the eyes of God. And that is the problem. Their worship is all external. It's all just actions. They're missing the spirit of the reason they're called to do these things. Their heart is so far from God that they make a mockery of God himself in the midst of his own temple. Right? This is the household of God, is how the Bible describes it. Imagine that. You come into God's house and you do this. It's terrible. And to be honest with you, this needs to be a warning to us. Now, I know we don't worship at the temple anymore. The temple actually doesn't exist anymore. It was destroyed in 70 AD. And we aren't meant to flock or to worship in a specific location. Jesus says fundamentally in the church age in which we now live, we worship in spirit and truth, no longer in location. Right? We have the Holy Spirit. We have direct access to God whenever we want. He's holy and utterly present with us all the time, even if we realize that or not. So we don't have a physical location to worship. Now, we gather at the church, of course, because we've designated this to be a place set apart for that. But you still, at an individual level, have direct access to God. But this is a warning for us, even in the church age, even apart from the temple. God desires pure and undefiled worship. God desires pure and undefiled worship. And that should take or cause you to have a little bit of self-reflection. Is my worship here pleasing to the Lord? Because we are in the presence of God right now. I hope you understand that. Well, later in this message, we'll get into more detail on what that actually looks like. But when the people of God come together, the Bible actually describes that as the new temple of God. That God manifests his presence and his grace when his people are gathered together to worship him. So we need to be coming to this case or this place as we gather with awe and reverence. We need to make sure that our hearts are in the right place well before we step through that door. You know, even myself, I can tell the mornings where maybe I wake up groggy, I'm a little bit off, and I probably more than anyone as I'm giving a message needs to be the most worshipful as I do this. And sometimes there's mornings, Sundays, where I'm not in it. Now, a lot happens before I get to this place on those mornings. I probably spend an hour listening to worship music and just praising the Lord by myself. I stay in Scripture. I pray. I ask the Lord to make sure I'm ready for this. And, you know, he always fulfills that. I'm not saying it's always great, because that's on me, not him. But we have to come here with our hearts already ready. And I understand that some mornings, right, kids and chaos and getting dressed and just weather, whatever it might be, there is chaos. But when we come and we gather together, let's recognize we're somewhere holy. It's not holy because of location. It's not holy because of these walls. It's holy because we are the gathered people of the Lord and we're here together to worship him. And there needs to be a level of respect towards God when it comes that way. Now, I want to read a little bit of scripture here from the Old Testament because, sadly, the Jews have not learned their lesson from their ancestors. If you read the book of Malachi, really the thrust of Malachi is that the people were worshiping God in a highly improper way. Highly improper way. In fact, they, at that time, even worse than even this situation in the temple, they would bring their animals that were sick, that were lame, that were blind, the ones that it didn't actually hurt you to sacrifice. Right? There wasn't that kind of economic financial pain in getting rid of that animal. In fact, it was a burden gotten rid of by making that sacrifice. That's not what God is calling us to. It's not what he was calling them to. In fact, if you read in Malachi even further, the Jews were stealing and by violence taking animals from other people to make sacrifices. Again, completely missing the mark of this. Completely missing the point. It was supposed to be from you giving the best, your first fruits to God in recognition of his provision and love for you. And they weren't doing that. And this is actually what it says in Malachi 1:10. Oh, that there were one among you who would shut the doors, that you might not kindle fire on my altar in vain. I have no pleasure in you, says the Lord of hosts, and I will not accept an offering from your hand. I mean, that, what an indictment that is. And he's talking about the temple. God would rather the doors of the temple be closed forever if that vain worship continued. He doesn't want it. It's not worship. It's not. If anything, it's self-worship, right? Because who are you thinking about when you do those things? You're not thinking about God. You're thinking about you. And so he indicts them for their awful, horrible worship. In fact, in that same text, he says, is this not evil, what you do? He said, in another case, he says, could you take that to your governor as an offering and they'd accept that? The one who rules over you, would they accept this as an offering? And let alone you think I, God, who am over them, would accept this? No. No. Clearly the evidence is there is that, yeah, they're going through the motions. Their heart is so far from God. They're so blind to that reality. But again, this is a warning for us. So let me ask you this. Does the Lord have any pleasure in the worship that you offer here? Do you ever ask yourself that question? When I come here and I come to worship, is it pleasing to the Lord? Am I actually honoring him here? Or am I just too focused on what I want and what I think this church should be giving to me? Again, that's not worship of the Lord. That's worship of self. That's self-centered worship, not self-sacrificial worship. Let me give you maybe a few diagnostic tools to see if this is where we're at today. When it comes to our ministries, let me ask you this. Now, caveat, I'm not saying we're perfect in any way here. I'm not saying we have this nailed down. There's plenty to change and do and move forward in. Absolutely. But what is your attitude towards the ministries we have here? If you find yourself in a place where you're grumbling and complaining and gossiping about the way things are done, and yet you're not willing to do anything about it, you're not worshiping. You're focusing on yourself. I would love it if you do have a problem in any way, come talk to me. Come talk to the leadership. Come talk to the deacons. And maybe you have, so I don't want to indict everyone here. But can you see what I'm saying here? If you're willing to just see a problem and go, I'm really frustrated that's a problem, and I'm going to tell everyone I know that I think this is a problem, and then not be willing to be the solution, you need to examine your heart when it comes to this church and who you are here. Because that's not worshipful attitude when you're here. That's a what can this place give to me attitude. That's not what the church is supposed to be. The church is supposed to be, how can I serve and love those who are here with me? How can I honor the Lord in the way that I interact and love the people here? You'll see that in a number of Paul's letters. What is the issue? The people of the church aren't loving one another the right way. It's the main problem in most of his letters. Now, there's some doctrinal issues in some of those letters too, which the result of that is a lack of love towards one another. So you need your theology right first and foremost if you're going to get the love part right, certainly. How about this? Music. Music is controversial. And it has been in the church age for a long time now. Oh, we want this type of music. Oh, we want this type of music. We want these instruments. We want this type of instrument. We don't want that instrument. It's not loud enough. It's too loud. I mean, I've heard it all. What is that attitude, though, behind that? When you come here and you say, this isn't the way I want it, you're not here for Jesus. You're here for you. You know what would be awesome? You know what's truly a worshipful attitude when it comes to the music? And I understand music's in a very important part of our service. It is. We're supposed to sing spiritual songs and hymns to one another. But you know what would be great? If we had the one camp that's saying, I want this type of music, and the other camp that's saying, I want this type of music, rather than going, this is what I want, go, you know what? I love my brothers and sisters, and I want us to sing the songs they want because I love them, and I want them to be able to worship the Lord. What I want us to do as a church is outdo one another in self-sacrifice, not self-centeredness. That's a worshipful attitude. If you come into this place and you humbly go, you know what? I do love the songs that I know. But I also want my brothers and sisters in Christ to be able to worship strongly too. So let's sing those songs. If it means that I don't get any of the songs that I want for a long time, okay. We're worshiping. There's awe and reverence. And I'm not saying one camp does that over the other. I'm saying both camps need to be outdoing one another in that attitude. Because then we're truly worshiping the Lord. Then we're truly showing to the Lord we love this gathering. And we love Him. And what did Jesus say? The world will know that you love me by the way you love one another. So the way you love people here is actually an act of worship. Because it's saying, you know what, first and foremost, I serve the Lord, not myself. And what about this? Giving. I know that I've been harping on giving here a little bit, mainly because we've been under what we need on a monthly basis, especially within this year. But I'm going to ask it this way. Are you robbing God? The reason I say it that way is because that's exactly what God says in Malachi. The people in Malachi's time period were withholding the tithe that God had commanded them to give. And likely because they were fearful. Right? The reason you hold anything back is because you're afraid. You're afraid that, oh, if I give away more than I can actually give away, then I'm going to be in a financially tough situation. What that attitude reveals is that you don't trust the Lord to provide. Now, I'm not necessarily saying you need to just sell all your possessions, get rid of your house, and just give us that lump sum. That's not what I'm saying at all. But give back to God what He gave you. It is robbing God if you withhold from the church what actually belongs to God. That's why He says that in Malachi. You're just borrowing what belongs to God. It's just on loan. The intention is for it to be given back and then to work tenfold for the fruit of the kingdom. You know, we aren't here to, you know, necessarily make investments and make a business out of this. That's not the goal here. The goal is to serve and love one another. And to do it with a worshipful attitude. And we do that with our finances just as much as we do with our time and other resources and skills and gifting. Everything we do here needs to be done through that worshipful attitude. And it needs to change from, okay, I'm here and what can this church give to me, to, okay, I'm here and what can I give to this church? How can I build up the body of Christ that is here? That is true and pure worship. That is the worship that God loves and is pleased with. I don't want us to become like the Jews here. We're making a marketplace in the temple, in the place where they get to meet God. We should be in a state where, and I'm not saying it's a spiritual experience necessarily, but it should be in a state of worship, a state of awe and reverence. Knowing that God is here among us. And that should, again, cause some self-reflection. How am I going into this knowing that God will be there? How will I worship Him today? How will my actions express what my heart truly believes about God? Now, we all have ways we need to work, including myself. But I see that as a warning in this text and what's going on here. So here's Jesus' response, looking at verse 15. And making a whip of cords, He drove them all out of the temple with the sheep and the oxen, and He poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. And He told those who sold the pigeons, take these things away. Do not make my Father's house a house of trade. His disciples remembered that it was written, zeal for your house will consume me. So Jesus' response, His action towards this, is that He cleanses the temple. He drives them out. I want to make sure we are clear on one thing. This whip of cords He makes is not for the people. I don't know if there's a misconception there. Sometimes we think that and that He's using the whip of cords on the people. It's not for the people. It's for the animals. Getting the animals to leave that area of the temple would have been very hard without some sort of prodding device. And so practically speaking, He's like, I need a whip to get these animals out of here. But that's what He does. He drives them out. And certainly the people selling the animals, He's driving out too. Just like it says there in verse 16, my Father's house cannot be a house of trade. This is supposed to be a house of worship. This is supposed to be a place where we commune with a holy God, and we're defiling that by our actions. And you notice what he says here about God. This is the first time, actually, I believe, in the book of John, where Jesus himself is recording calling God his Father. And that'll certainly set up the theme for the rest of John's gospel. But it's recognizing that Jesus has a bit more at stake here with himself, because it's not just the place of Yahweh where people come and worship. It's his own Father's house. And here, this zeal for your house will consume me. It's quoting from Psalm 69:9, where David actually is in a similar situation where his enemies are reviling him and they're against him. And what they're mostly despising is the temple. Is the temple. And so David, in this prophetic psalm, is saying, zeal for your temple will consume me, because this is where you reside with us. If you have zeal for the temple of God, you have love, fervent love for God himself, because they're synonymous with one another. The house of God, the temple of God, God himself. And so Jesus, or the disciples, are recognizing prophetically that Jesus fulfills this. That Jesus is consumed with zeal for his Father's house, because he and the Father are one. Jesus is God in the flesh. So in one sense, he's saying, yeah, it's my Father's house, but it's my house too. And it's been desecrated by vain and evil acts of so-called worship. And that's, as you see there, my sub-point B here for this section is, Jesus will always purify his people. The picture here isn't just purifying the temple or cleansing the temple. That's a physical location, and not nearly as important as the people's hearts when they come there. And Jesus will always cleanse and purify his people. Now, to put this in even more addressed context, there's just a quote from one of the commentaries I used for this message this week that just really stuck with me, so I want to read that for you. This is D.A. Carson. He says, instead of solemn dignity and the murmur of prayer, there is the bellowing of cattle and the bleating of sheep. Instead of brokenness and contrition, holy adoration and prolonged petition, there is noisy commerce. I mean, that's what Jesus is seeing when he sees the temple be a house of trade. Now, we can all agree, if we brought any sheep in here and we're trying to worship in the midst of them being sheep, that would be distracting and difficult. It just wouldn't work. You'd be distracted, your attitude couldn't be focused on that. And again, it's not even the presence of the sheep or the cattle that's the issue. It's the hearts of the people that is the issue here. And Jesus is making it very clear through his actions how he feels about that. You'll notice this as well when it comes to Jesus always purifying his people. And that's because he's zealous for pure worship. As he cleanses us, it causes us to be able to have more pure worship as we mature in our faith. This is Malachi 3, 1 and verse 1 and verse 3. And Jesus fulfills this in his actions here. Then suddenly the Lord you are seeking, so that is to say you Jews who are seeking the Messiah and longing for him, when he finally comes to you, he will come to his temple and he will purify the Levites, that is the priests, and refine them like gold and silver. He's talking about the priests who run the temple, who are oversee the function of the temple. Realize the indictment here. Who do you think allowed the marketplace to happen in the temple? It was the priests. The people who know better and are tasked with God to make sure that remains a place of worship. So by indicting the priests or mentioning this about the priests and purifying them, what he's recognizing is that the way the priests go, the way the people go. The way the priests go, the way the people go. The people are led astray by the priests because of their actions. And of course, they're the ones who are going to interact with Jesus here as we get into verse 18. But notice this. This is 1 Peter 4:17, as I bring this back into the church age and how Jesus will always be purifying his church. It says this, for it is time for judgment to begin at the household of God. And what is Peter saying the household of God is? In this case, the church. And think about that. Judgment begins in the church. Why? Because God desires his church to be holy. He desires his church to be pure and undefiled. So he's going to start right where it is the people who are supposed to be glorifying him the most in their worship. And he's going to make sure we do that well. And we can rely on the Spirit and his grace to us for that. And again, even the statement by Peter made 2,000 years ago, he says, it is time. Not it will be time, or it was time, or that time is past. It is time for the judgment to begin at the household of God. And so, you know, that's not necessarily a prayer I have, but if I see a church that is fundamentally opposed to God or is teaching things that contradict Scripture, I'm happy when those doors close. So exactly going back to Malachi 1, oh, that there would be someone there who would shut the doors on that vain worship. I'm fine with that. Because I want those people to repent and believe in the true gospel and not what they're doing. And I pray that's true here at Gateway. That we rid ourselves of whatever earthly man-made wisdom we might have and we just fully and utterly rely on the Scriptures as our authority. Period. Knowing that we want Jesus to come and purify us. That's something we should desire. Because we want to be holy like God is holy. We want to be like Christ. Because in becoming more like him, we can love one another better, we can serve the community better, we can glorify God better, we can call the lost to repentance better. We can function better as what the church is tasked to do, which is to proclaim the gospel, call people to repentance, and then to mature the believers who are here, that we might all be ready for the day that Jesus returns. So here's the second section going into verse 18. The replacement of the temple. Notice here what happens. So the Jews said to him, so the Jews in this case are the authorities of the temple, the priests, it's those who run this operation. And they come to him and they go, what sign do you show us for doing these things? The audacity and boldness that they have to come to the Messiah and ask this question. All right, because think about what they're saying here. First and foremost, Jesus performs this action that's supposed to be provocative and spark self-reflection. And the first thing the authorities of the temple do is question Jesus' authority. Right? They're worried about their authority in the temple being undermined. This is exactly what's happening here. They're not taking time for self-reflection. They're not taking time to go, oh, wow, okay, what he's doing, maybe this is just. Maybe this is what needs to happen here. Maybe we've been wrong and we need to repent of this. They don't do that at all. They're frustrated and angry, and they see Jesus as a threat, and they go to him, and they go, by what authority do you even do what you're doing right now? We didn't give you permission for this. And so just think about the earthliness, the worldliness that consumes them for them to fail in such an amazing way. And here's even further the problem. You know, if they had just thought Jesus was a raving lunatic, there were other methods for confronting him and removing him from the temple. Their statement here actually gives them away. There's a hint in their minds that Jesus might be a real prophet. And so they ask him for a sign. But do you realize how blind they are to not realize that Jesus just actually performed a sign for them? Do you realize that? Jesus comes and with zeal for the house of God, he cleanses it so it can return back to what it's supposed to be. And they go, what sign are you going to give us? And he's going, did you not just see what I did? This is a sign for you. This is who I am. I am the Messiah come to you to save you from your sin. And you are so blind by your worldliness and your love for power and authority that you completely missed the point of what I just did. Also, can I just say, God does not bow the knee to humanity and give a sign just because fallen humanity demands one from him. That's not God. God doesn't need our favor. He doesn't need our allegiance in that way or an alliance in that way, at least the way the Pharisees would want one. He doesn't do that. Ever. But no, Jesus actually is kind of gracious to them in this case. Notice what he says here in verse 19. basically saying this, you want a sign? You missed this one, which was pretty obvious. You want a real sign? Well, let me show you one. He says, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up again. Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up again. Now, all of us post-cross, post-resurrection, understand what he's talking about. And John, as the commentator, will clarify that later. Look at verse 21. But he was speaking about the temple of his body. That's John interjecting commentary to help us understand what Jesus is saying. Jesus isn't talking about the real physical temple that was in Jerusalem. He's talking about himself. And Jesus calls himself the temple. Why? Because the fullness of God dwells in him. He is the true and better temple. There's a permanent dwelling of God in him because he's God in the flesh. Now, think about it that way. The temple is where you go and you commune with God, although there's a distance. And again, the high priest can only see God once a year at most. So there's a limitation on that relationship. It's a veiled relationship. It's a distant relationship, even though there's a relationship. And even to even be there in the presence, you have to make your sacrifices and do it with the right heart attitude that it would be pleasing to the Lord. But in Christ, we have direct access to God and communion with God because he is the sacrificial lamb for us. He is the one as our high priest who laid his life down for us once and for all to satisfy the law and wrath of God. And he is himself God in the flesh that we might have direct access to him. That's why the veil to the Holy of Holies was torn upon Christ's death. There is no more separation. We have God. We have God now. And so Christ is the better temple in that way. And I just love that picture. I'd never really thought about that way until I'm prepping for this text and understanding better what's going on here. But that's exactly what Jesus is saying. That was temporary. That's old. That's under the old covenant. We're not doing that anymore. We have something better. We have the real temple of God. God in the flesh. God in human form. Walking among us. Ever present with us, although not bodily right now, for us. And so that is his sign for them. Right? And understand, this is the same, my hour has not come from the previous text we look at. It's the same hour he's referring to, his time of glorification. You want a sign? See me after I'm resurrected. That'll be your sign. My death and my resurrection to proclaim to you fully my glory is all the sign you are ever going to need. And certainly bless those who never see the Lord yet still believe in him. That's what he says, right? Blessed are those who, although yet not seeing, still believe. And so he is for us the way we commune with God, the way we have direct access to God. And like I said earlier, as Jesus says in the Gospels, we no longer worship in a physical location. It's only about spirit and truth. We worship in spirit because God himself is spirit. And that's how we're connected to him by the giving of the Holy Spirit to us. That is our means of connection with the Lord. It's actually the same thing as being born again. You have no spiritual connection to God until you are born again. Born of the Spirit, born of God, as all the phrases that John likes to use in his gospel and then his epistles. Notice their response, though, here in verse 20. The Jews then say to him, it has taken 46 years to build this temple, and you will raise it in 3 days? They lack complete understanding of what he's saying. They're not getting it at all. And you know what he's doing, though? He is actually having a conversation about authority. The one who's able to destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, as opposed to 46 years, they actually have the right to claim authority over the function of the temple, don't they? If they can destroy it and then rebuild it, they have full and complete authority. And of course, Jesus is talking about himself, yes, but he's also talking about his authority. I have all the authority in the world, is what Jesus is saying, because this world is mine. This is my temple. I commanded your ancestors to build it. I gave them the schematics of how to build it. I provided for them the gifting and skill set so that it would be a beautiful masterpiece. That all came from me. because Jesus himself is God. And of course, John provides a little extra commentary on this, starting in verse 21, but he was speaking about the temple of his body. And when therefore he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. It didn't even click for the disciples until after the resurrection. Until after the resurrection. That was the final piece of all of this that finally made sense, everything that Jesus was saying. You see that especially in the Gospel of Mark, and as we've been going through that, you see how frequently in Mark he records the disciples just not understanding at all what Jesus is saying. And it's because the resurrection hasn't happened yet. That puts together everything that he's been saying, all the teaching, all the signs, all the function, his complete glory. And yet we are in an age where we get to see that, where we get to recognize that, we get to believe that. And notice what he says here, right? First and foremost, in seeing his resurrection, they believe the scriptures. It's an interesting statement to make, right? But that's what he says. No, they recognize that the scriptures pointed towards Jesus, and through his resurrection and all that he did, he fulfills it. Excuse me. And then, of course, they believed in the words that Jesus spoken. Why? Because what Jesus said lines up with what scripture said. It's his word. You can't have one without the other. So they believe both in the scriptures that point to Jesus and what Jesus said about himself and what he did, because it aligns up with the scriptures too. Now I want to push this a little bit further as we gather to a close here. Because yes, Jesus is the true and better temple, and that's the main focus of his statement here. And of course, the sign of his glory and being the better temple is his death and resurrection. But understand this, coming back to really my more application about us as the church. The Bible actually also says that we as the church are the temple of God too. Jesus is no longer physically with us. He's here with us spiritually, yes. But this physical body is not with us on the earth right now. That won't happen until his second coming. But let me read for you a couple verses here just so we understand better. That we are, as the church, are the temple of God in the world, both corporately and individually. Corporately, I mean the gathering of the people of God. This is 1 Corinthians 3:16-17. It says this, "Do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him. For God's temple is holy and you are that temple." The context of 1 Corinthians 3 is that he's talking to the Corinthian church as a whole. He's not talking to them individually right now. He's saying when you gather together, when you do what you do for worship, you are the temple of God because each of you has the Spirit dwelling within you. And so this is basically the gathering of those who have been spiritually born again. God is there. That is his temple. And so, as it goes in 1 Corinthians 3, you need to approach this with awe and reverence. You need to do this according to God's word and have the right heart and mind attitude about it. And then, of course, individually as well, he brings this up in 1 Corinthians 6. This is 19 through 20. "Or do you not know that your body," right, there's the individual language, "your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God. You are not your own. You were bought with a price. So glorify God in your body." Yeah, you were bought at a price. The blood of Jesus. You don't belong to even yourself. That's what he says there. You are not your own. You're Christ's. You're God's. Because he bought you and he freed you. Now he's the one you serve and love. So glorify God with your body. In that context, Paul is actually calling the Corinthians to flee specifically from sexual immorality, but the principle is any sin. Do you not realize that when you sin, you are actually the temple of God? You are bringing the Holy Spirit into your sin? That's exactly what he's saying there. So we need to recognize that although, yes, Jesus is the true and better temple in the sense that he is the fullness of God dwelling in him, we as the church, both gathered and individually, are reflections of Jesus being the true temple. We're a mirror image of that. So people need to look at us and see God just the way that we can look at Jesus and see God. That's the expectation and the command here. And I really pray, I know maybe today was a little bit more aggressive, but I'm praying that this is giving you all time, or at least a thought of self-reflection when it comes to how do we gather to worship the Lord? How do we do this? Where is my heart? Where is my mind? What is my attitude here when we gather together? Knowing that I am the temple of God and I'm supposed to express the glory of God in how I act and behave towards one another. And how do we do that as a gathered body of believers? It needs to be taken seriously. This isn't entertainment hour. This isn't just do whatever I think is right. This is do what Christ has commanded us to do and to love one another with grace and mercy in the midst of that. That we all would be made more mature in our faith, because that is the ultimate goal here. Let's pray. Father, we do praise you deeply for your love for us. For we know that there actually is no boundary for your love. It's an unending love, unending favor that you show us. And you don't show it to us or provide it for us because of anything good in us, but only because of the complete goodness in you. And Father, I pray that we would take this text seriously as a warning, that we would recognize our worship needs to be filled with awe and reverence because we are the new temple. We are how you manifest your presence in the world. And when we act and behave in a way that is the opposite of what you've commanded, we actually communicate something false about who you are to the world. I pray that that would sink into our hearts and we would really truly fight against our fleshly impulses, fight against our sin, fight against our self-centeredness, that we might truly and purely worship you, and that we would love one another here in the context of this church, knowing that that's what truly brings you honor and glory. So, Father, I pray all these things in the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen. I invite you to stand as we continue to sing.
Of the world, Jesus.
Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven. Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. Jesus Messiah, Lord of all.
Let's pray together, church. Father, we thank you that you are the Lord above all. God, I pray that as we leave this place, we continue to worship you this week and everything we do, God, putting you at the focus, lifting you up because you are worthy of it all. God, everything's for you. Thank you for what you're doing here and continue to bless us and help us to serve you. It's in your son's name I pray, in the name of Jesus. Amen. You all are dismissed. Have a great week.
Seems like all I could see was the struggle. Haunted by ghosts that lived in my past. Bound up in shackles of all my fears. This prisoner and say to me, son, stop fighting a fight, it's already been won. And I am redeemed, you set me free, so I'll shake off these heavy chains.
Tomorrow.